Do you think that, say, machine learning and artificial intelligence could create even more direct consumer-tailored advertisements that might be even more harmful than current advertisements?
Mm-hmm. I think that, for sure, they can create more tailored advertisements. Now, the way to think about, so if I'm wearing just my economist cap, the advertising could be beneficial if it matches you better to the product. So if it saves you time from searching for a product. So one thing that advertising can do is to cut down on your search costs, and that's good. Now, the way that that can be bad is if the firms now know that this is what you like. And that means I know that I can get more money out of you for this product. So you don't have to pay for search costs, but I'm taking all of your surplus. And so it's a two-edged sword.
Dr. Sovinsky, thank you very much for taking the time today. I see you've brought an interesting object that we'll get to later then.
Okay, thank you very much for having me.
So to start, I'd like to talk a bit about your academic and very international journey so far. So you're now at the University of Mannheim, having also been at the University of Southern California in the States, the University of Zurich, and visiting professorships at both Melbourne and Bocconi. So with such an international career in academia so far, what appealed to you personally when you came back and joined the Mannheim community in 2015?
As it's kind of common in academics that you meet faculty along the way. And so over my career path, I got to know the people that were in the Department of Economics here, and especially the ones that are in my exact field, which is empirical industrial organization, which is basically just like the study of firm behavior and individual behavior. And I realized that it's a very strong department in my field. And at some point, an opportunity came up to join the faculty, and I talked about it with them, and I thought, oh, this would be a lovely place to be. And I really liked the idea of living in Germany.
So talking about economics, what do you value the most about the German university system?
I think there's a few things, but one thing that I really like is the German students and the students that study at Mannheim, in my opinion, are very well prepared. So I feel like the level of responsibility is quite high. So you can already push them in ways that helps you get more out of yourself. The students that we have here, because it is a good school, and the selection is, you know, hard, and so you get students that want to learn, and that means that as a faculty member, you can even give them more challenging things to do, and so you become more responsible. Also related to that, when you are around other students that also want to learn, that also want to push themselves, you raise up to that level. You have a nice group that it's fun to teach and that they are wanting to see what they can accomplish, you know?
So now I'd like to transition a bit to your research work. Mm-hmm. So your research expertise lies in game theoretic modeling and also public health. Mm-hmm. And game theory, just the word in itself, sounds quite fun. Mm-hmm. So what are, say, the basics of game theory, and how do you implement that in your research work?
You know, when you're playing a game and you, let's say it's a strategic game. So, and chess is maybe a good example. And you have to decide, okay, do I want to move that piece? So what do I think the response would be if I move that piece? But you also know that your opponent is thinking the same thing. And so game theory basically says, before you take an action, you think about what the reaction of your rivals would be. In a lot of cases, it's firms, because I think about firms setting prices. If I want to set a price for some water, I need to think about what are my rivals' prices going to be. And they are going to think about what are my prices going to be. And so it's very similar into a game, right? And so what game theory says is the price that you settle on in the end is one where that's my best response to whatever you do. I couldn't do any better, meaning earn higher profits, by choosing a different price. And so game theory just tells us, how do we get to that point?
So now to be a bit more detailed with your research, one of your research publications was about advertisements as a major source of human dissatisfaction. And I saw it in The Economist, a very well-known newspaper. What is your stance on the often, say, dissatisfying advertisements that students and young adults are increasingly seeing nowadays in common media?
What that paper was about is there's this field of research in economics called happiness research. So there's something in the field called the happiness paradox. And that is, as countries get richer, let's say measured as GDP, their survey responses to how happy you are not increasing in the GDP of that country. So it seems like richer countries aren't necessarily happier. Now, one thing that's correlated with richer countries is more advertising. And so the question became, well, is it being explained partly because of this advertising? And indeed, we found that higher advertising is correlated with lower levels of happiness.
Do you think that, say, machine learning and artificial intelligence could create even more direct consumer-tailored advertisements that might be even more harmful than current advertisements?
I think that for sure they can create more tailored advertisements. So if I'm wearing just my economist cap, the advertising could be beneficial if it matches you better to the product. So one thing that advertising can do is to cut down on your search costs, and that's good. Now, the way that that can be bad is if the firms now know that this is what you like, and that means I know that I can get more money out of you for this product. I think with AI, you're definitely going to see a lot more potential to what we call price discriminate. So this charging the price all the way from what you're willing to pay, that's a type of price discrimination that's called third degree. It's like I'm charging you exactly what you're willing to pay. Now, I just gave you that bike, showed you where to get it, so you don't have to pay for search costs, but I'm taking all of your surplus. And so it's a two-edged sword, I think, there.
So with such an interesting topic and very relevant topic, is this research work something students can expect to be involved in when they come to Mannheim?
Yeah, I think one of the things that I like about working in Mannheim is the close interaction that we have with students. And what economics does more generally is indeed provide these tools to teach you how to write down a model of demand, what things enter into your decision-making process. And so what economics does is it says, okay, you make a decision about what product to buy, what matters for that decision. All those things that matter for that decision make up your demand. And what you learn in economics is how to practically turn these thoughts into something that you can figure out what's going to happen in the end. And so when you study economics and when you start to get the tools, it's a very good approximation to reality. Yeah. And then you start to learn slowly, you make it more and more complicated. After you get more tools, you make it more complicated, until you get something that you can in the end come out with predictions. And so indeed, when you study at economics, you have to start at the first level, and eventually you're writing a thesis on organ donation in Germany. Yeah.
So you talked about work-life balance and how it was an important factor for you coming to Europe. So I'm wondering if the speaker that you've brought today, if that has anything to do with your personal work-life balance.
Music plays a large part in my life, both because it it is something that I use to relax, but also because I do it in combination with sports. And what I found is that whenever I have a lot going on, like a student who has a lot of tests in 1 week, or you have a lot of just otherwise work that you need to do, sometimes it helps to get out and to, for me, to exercise, because the endorphins that my body gets, it's pretty well known that the endorphins that exercise generates helps you to combat anxiety, stress, even depression. And sometimes I need to be on the bike, the spin bike, for an hour and a half before I actually forgot about some meeting that I had, or, you know, finally start to feel like a human being again.
Yeah.
But I really feel like music plays a large role in that, because when I'm doing sports, I tend to be listening to the music.
Mm-hmm.
And so those two things are very related for me.
Here at the university, we have a large sports offering, sports A through Z.
That's true.
I never knew of before. So,
and cycling here is really nice because you have the outdoor, like a lot of really cool places within a reasonable distance and beautiful places. And I cycle to work because I live really close to the university.
So as students are thinking about university then, what are some things that they can look forward to here at the University of Mannheim?
One thing that impresses me is there is a very vibrant student community. There always seems to be something being organized, like some music event, some sports event, some talk, some dinner, some something. So there's a very high interaction, I think, among students and specific groups as well. And so I think you get the academic career, the first reason that you're here, but then you get a lot of social support. And one thing I also like about Mannheim is it's not this overwhelmingly large city. And so it feels very doable, right?
Definitely.
That you can go by bike or walking to some nice area and then later go have dinner in another nice area. And you're surrounded kind of by these nice waterways, which I think are very well. We have really nice like little places to have a drink next to every single one of them.
Yeah.
And I think that that's nice to have this social environment outside of academics. So I like that about Mannheim.
Wonderful.
In general. I also like that in Mannheim you have quite a few places like on roofs,
mm-hmm.
where you have these cool views of things.
Rooftop
and
places.
Yes.
Well, thank you very much then. I've had a great time.
Thank you.
Really
me
enjoyed
too.
Our conversation.
So have I. Thank you very much for asking me.